Thank you so much. I'm very excited to be today here talking about this field of science, environmental health. But before we start, I have a very important question for you, super important. Please raise your hand if you like dogs more than cats. Okay, good. Please raise your hand if you like cats more than dogs. Okay, we have a problem. No, we don't have a problem. It's totally fine. We're not gonna judge you for thinking that. But we can clearly see that there's a disagreement in this room, right? Now allow me to change a little bit the question. Please raise your hand if you think being healthy is more important than becoming rich and having lots of money. Okay? Please raise your hand if you think becoming rich and having lots of money is more important than being healthy. Okay, I see some. It's fine. We don't judge you either. But as you can see here, there's less of a disagreement, right? Most of us agree that health is such an important factor for us. And this is exactly why I'm talking about health today. I know this is a topic that a lot of people are interested in, and health is a concept that brings us together in a world that gives us millions of reasons to disagree on, right? As we saw with the questions that you have asked. Now, health, when people think about health, they usually think, okay, I get sick, I go to the doctor, they give me medicine, and I'm cured. And yes, part of health is like that, but there's also a preventive side of health. And that's why I'm here to talk to you about environmental health, which is a branch of public health. And in order to explain this concept to you, which is gonna be pretty interesting, I hope, I'm gonna give you a very basic description or definition. So environmental health studies how the environment influences human health. Seems pretty straightforward, right? It doesn't seem like a sophisticated or very difficult definition to understand. But what do we mean by environment? Most of you are thinking about the natural environment, which is soil, air, water, chemical, physical, biological factors within the natural environment. But we also mean the social environment. For example, our socioeconomic status, lifestyle consumption patterns, et cetera. And we also mean man-made environment or the built environment. This is everything that surrounds us that was created by men. For example, this room, the car that you took to come here, the train, the projector, everything that is surrounding us, that's the man-made environment. And this is when this concept becomes a little bit tricky because, well, not a little bit, pretty tricky. You have to integrate these three dimensions of the environment in order to see what is affecting human health. It seems like a very broad topic, and it's because it is. This is a field of science that is very multidisciplinary, and in order to learn it and to study it, you need sometimes multidisciplinary groups. In order to give you an example and for you to understand it better and the complexity of this concept, I'm gonna give you an example from my own country. I'm from Mexico, in case you couldn't tell from my accent. There's fellow Mexicans here, I've met them already. And first of all, I wanna talk to you about my country. So this is Mexico, this is a country that is in constant development, mega diverse country, pretty high GDP according to the International Monetary Fund. Very cultural place, beautiful landscapes, everybody wants to be there right now. Lot of fauna and very good food. So yes, I'm showing off my country a little bit, but I'm also the first one to admit we have issues, right? And one of the issues is that almost 50% of the population lives in poverty conditions. Now, this is a very strong factor within the social environment dimension. I'm gonna talk about a specific vulnerable group in Mexico, which is, well, you're gonna see, it's even worse when it comes to poverty. Here in green, you can see the moderate poverty, in red, extreme poverty. At the end of the day, both of them are poverty conditions. So indigenous population reaches over 70% of the people in poverty conditions. Indigenous people, in case you don't know, are native, original people from these places, and these are two friends that I made while I was working there. So as you can imagine, working with these communities is a little bit difficult, and they have some environmental risks that come, or environmental health risks that come from the social factor of poverty. So I worked here. Well, I work with the Center of Applied Research in Environment and Health. This is a center that is affiliated with the World Health Organization. We work, this is my country, and here highlighted, it has the shape of a schnauzer dog. That's my state, San Luis Potosí. San Luis Potosí, 11% of its population is indigenous communities, and they are all in the tail of the Schnauzer, it's Huasteca zone. So as you can see, it's very beautiful, lots of fauna, very green. You go there and somewhere in between these trees, you're gonna find these indigenous populations. They use local resources on a daily basis. This is the infrastructure of their houses and generally of everything, with palm roofs. And these are two friends that I made there, Adrian and Dulce. Now, they are living here, and remember, we arrived there and we wanted to do environmental health studies, right? So we knew about the poverty factor. We knew about the social factor. We wanted to check how is this affecting their health. We found a lot of things, way more than here, but I'm gonna give you some examples. These are the roofs that you can find in most of the houses. They look pretty black, and it's because they cook with wood. So it's full of smoke inside of the house. There's no ventilation. Soot gets generated here, which has aromatic polycyclic hydrocarbons that are related to cancer, to some respiratory diseases, etc. When they don't have these roofs, the wealthiest of all, they change them to metal roofs. Now this seems a bit better, but the problem with metal roofs is that right now they are around 40 degrees Celsius. So imagine the heat stroke risk here. This is another health risk that's coming from this man-made environment, which is the roof. You can also find these types of containers in the backyards with water. The problem here is that this is the perfect environment for mosquitoes to reproduce in these tropical zones. And these mosquitoes sometimes carry diseases such as dengue that can be lethal for kids and that also don't have a cure, most of them. It's sometimes in the backyards you can find electronic waste. This is just there. And of course, it's releasing heavy metals that also people are exposed to and can create cancer or are related to cancer. There's a poor waste management system, so there's no truck that comes and pick up their trash. They just burn everything in front of their houses. Who knows what's being burned there? Who knows what fumes are? We know there's dioxins, which are pretty expensive to measure, for example. But this is another health risk that they have. Malnutrition, due to the poverty and due to the lack of availability of food, the kids have a lack of nutrition, or the things that they have is like Coke or Lace. I don't know how you call them in English. Sabritas, we call them in Spanish. chips, yeah, sorry. And also, for them to get clean water, they have to take them from water wells, and they are, as the water well is depleted, then they have to go farther and farther to get clean water, several kilometers. This is a physical risk that results in more injuries, for example. Now, I'm gonna show you very fast an example of a project that we did here. This is a group that is very multidisciplinary, very big, but this is just one example, keep that in mind. So malnutrition. We work with mothers of children between 5 and 12 years old in this community. Tocó is a community. So we did a diagnosis. We arrive, what's happening here? What are they lacking? Are they really having issues with nutrition? Then we intervene, and then there's an evaluation. And this is a project that is still going on right now. With the diagnosis, we did several things. These are some of them. I'm gonna focus on this food consumption frequency questionnaire. With this questionnaire, we could check what are the nutrients that they are lacking. So we thought, okay, there's an issue. There's some nutrients that are lacking. What are we gonna do? We're gonna intervene, or we're gonna go there and teach them how to make better diets, right? We cannot do that without knowing what can they buy. You know, there's a poverty factor, so we're not gonna tell them, buy this super expensive thing in the supermarket when there's no supermarkets. So as you can imagine, this was very complex and very difficult to do. We did the intervention, which was workshops with the mothers, which are the ones that are in charge of cooking at home. We could generate a new diets based locally on this specific community with new recipes, and we did emphasis with micronutrients. For this, we worked with nutritionists and several other doctors, chemists, etc. For the evaluation, after 1 year, we did more questionnaires. We compared the growth of the children. And I'm gonna, as you can imagine, we got a lot of data out of this project, which is just part of the project. But I'm gonna show you just as an example, these were the main nutritional deficiencies that we found there. And in red is the ones that after 1 year of the intervention, we saw that they were consuming more again. Now, This is not done, of course, these are projects that take years and years and years to do. However, this is how you can do research in these very complex areas, for example. And as you can see here, okay, sounds very interesting, sounds complex, sounds exciting, but it's in Mexico. I've never been in Mexico, some of you might say. I don't know how they live, and I've never been in an indigenous community, so how can I relate to environmental health, and is it an issue for me? Well, in Germany, there's a lot of work going on with environmental health. However, the government has done a very good job with regulations and voluntary agreements, so you don't have to worry about it as much as indigenous communities, for example, or have it always in the back of your mind. They have the Environmental Action Program for 2020 with an amazing goal, living well within the limits of our planet. And they have 9 priority objectives, number 3 being environment and health. They include indoor and outdoor air pollution, which is a very important topic in general. They include clean water, and they include a topic that I think concerns to all of us, which is adaptation to climate change, also affecting human health. Now I'm gonna give you an example of something you might be more familiar with, mold. So mold is a fungus that can grow in the walls and in the roof of our houses, right? These fungus can cause spores, and when you are in contact with these spores, you can get asthma or dermal and mucosal irritations. We know this because of environmental health studies. Now, in Germany, there has been an increasing number of mold, and especially in winter, we don't want to open our windows because it's too cold outside, and then the humidity inside of the room gets crazy, and there's the perfect environment for the mold to grow. So what we do, especially what I do, is I have this device that measures the humidity in the room, and whenever I see it's going crazy, open everything, grab my blanket, and like freeze for a few minutes until the humidity gets better and there's no mold in my house. So we know this, and this is an example that you can see here. Another example is from my own campus. I study in Technische Universität Freising, Universität München, but in Freising. And they send me this email, which is, but you don't have to read it all. I can explain you very, very fast. So they found this moth in the oak trees near the campus. And they sent us this email. Guys, we found this moth. Alarm in red. Attention. The caterpillars of this moth have hairs that can fly for 100 meters, let's say. And if you are in contact with them, then your skin gets itchy. You can get allergy shock, for example. And they're telling us, basically, please avoid the oak trees in the campus. Don't walk there. If you have a car, don't park it underneath an oak tree. If you have a dog, don't leave it near the oak tree. So this is a natural environment factor that is affecting our health, and we know this also because of these studies. Now, my message to you, as you can see, is that environmental health is an everyday life topic. I'm sure a lot of you are already opening your windows because you don't want mold in your houses, and you're not thinking, oh, environmental health. These are things that we do every day, but there's a field of science behind all of that. And there's a reason why we do it, and there's a reason why we know that it works. Effective solutions for these type of issues require knowledge and require you to be able to integrate these 3 dimensions of the environment. So always think, I couldn't go to the indigenous community and tell them, okay, buy this expensive cheese or whatever it might be, or buy my meat because you need a certain thing. If I know that they cannot afford it. You need to think about the social environment too and about the mind and environment too. And environmental health, as you can see, is a very multidisciplinary topic. With these issues, at least in Mexico, we have sociologists, toxicologists, psychologists, doctors, everything working with us in order for us to make this type of studies and to study this. So please don't be scared to get involved. Even if you are from a different profession, you can always support something, you know? I'm sure there might be now apps coming out about climate change and apps about air pollution and things like that. So IT people can also join. I don't know. We're not judging. So if you want to volunteer in Munich, at least I know from Green City. Green City is an organization that works with a lot of things within the natural environment. But as you saw, everything is connected and everything at the end has an effect on human health in general. So I leave you the website in case you want to volunteer and get involved with these topics. And if you have any questions, I'm here. Thank you so much for listening to this talk.
Thank you very much, Joss. Let's see what kind of questions we have. Yes, please.
I have a question. Could you please tell a little bit about interventions?
Interventions?
Yeah. Who makes these decisions? Could you please give a couple of examples?
Yes.
I will just repeat the question. So the question is about interventions. Who are making decisions if the intervention should be taken and what kind of interventions and this kind of information?
Yes. So what we do, for example, in this type of small communities, we come with a university from the state, and we go there and we first do a diagnosis. And the interventions are always focused on the people. When it comes to indigenous communities, you have to be very careful not to go against their cultures or things like that. So we do the diagnosis, we see what are the environmental risks that we can find, as I showed you before. And then from there, we do just like with a group. We just take a group to try to intervene and see if there's a change. And once there's a change and we can prove that there was an issue there and that this got solved, then with this scientific data, we can actually go and this can work as a proof for the government to intervene in a higher scale with the whole community, for example. Is that kind of what you meant? Or for the research purposes at the beginning?
Could you give a couple of examples? What kind of interventions?
Okay, so apart from the malnutrition one, there's one that we did when we changed all the stoves from several people in this community, voluntary work. If you wanted an ecological stove, you get one provided by the government and some research budget. And then with these stoves, we measured if they were actually, the exposure to these aromatic polycyclic hydrocarbons was getting lower or not. And according to that, then they realized that there was actually a change, and then the government put more more ecological stoves for the rest of the people. There was another one when we realized the water wells were very far away, the clean water. So they put some storage, rainwater storages for the people to not have to move so far away. For the malnutrition one, there was another one that was, they taught the mothers also how to grow their own vegetables at home, because sometimes there was a lack of availability of them. So, and this area is very fertile. So we went there and then we taught them how to do it. We also saw, okay, what can be grown here? We have biologists too and people like this. And then after that, we also check again if this made a change, and then it can probably become bigger. But we need first several years of proof that there's a difference when we intervene.
Okay, thank you, Joss. Yes, there is a question here.
Is there an order of priority of taking care first of environment or people or man-made environment?
So the question is, if there is some order of priority, what should be taken care of first, environment or the health of people or man-made environment? So what's the priority?
Yes, well, in these complex scenarios, it's very difficult to tell. When you work with urbanized areas, it's very different than when you work with not urbanized areas. But what we do, that's why we do the diagnosis first, and we see, okay, what is the most urgent problem that they have? Because sometimes they want, for example, the metal roofs, but just because they look nice or, you know, something like this. So we try to see, okay, what is the most urgent thing that they need? And then from that, we also see, okay, they are dealing with malnutrition, for example. So maybe it's very expensive, or they don't, you know, it's very expensive in their local thing. So we think, okay, but that's not the only factor that is affecting malnutrition. Malnutrition is also, it's not only just giving them the food, but teaching them, okay, what are the diets that you can do with this, and how are these diets going to make a difference in the kid, for example. So most of the times it's very complex and there are big groups because several things are working together. It's not only one factor that we can focus on, but when it comes to the issues, we try to, as a team and as a multidisciplinary team, we say, what is the most urgent one? And what is the one that can cause an impact on several one of them? Because sometimes everything is interrelated.
Thank you. I think there was a question on the back somewhere. Was it there one? No, okay, yes.
So, I mean, from what I heard from your talk, it seems to be mostly, you know, a government-driven activity. I would just like to know, out of curiosity, which governments are spending the most of their budget on these kind of activities? Which countries are they, like, they lead by example if you have this kind of data?
Yes. So I don't have a specific data, but what we can know is that, for example, Costa Rica has made a lot of efforts to help with environmental health. And sometimes what we do, well, the research programs are not specifically driven by governments, but the intervention post-research sometimes can be driven by them. But what we have seen is that Costa Rica has done a lot of things like that, and health has made a big impact there because that's when the government spends a bit more money. If you tell them, okay, there's a monkey that is dying, blah, 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 you know, some governments are not very open to work with environmental stuff only. When you see, okay, the bees are dying here, but this is affecting the people that is living out of providing honey, and then these people then is having more issues, and this is costing you more, then that's when the government will provide more budget. We know that Costa Rica is one of the very strong ones.
Thank you very much, Jos. I suggest that the further questions can be asked later after we are over with the event and you have still some time to interact with our speakers. Thank you very much.
Yeah, you're welcome.